Well, dear brothers and sisters, we learned something in our gospel passage today, and it was that Jesus had a chauffeur. Did you know that? It said that the Spirit drove Jesus out into the desert. Well, today's readings turn our attention to the theme of repentance, a wonderful theme for the beginning of Lent. Especially, we heard those words of Jesus in the gospel passage, repent and believe in the gospel. Well, I was remembering recently that I was at the March for Life a few years ago, and every year, because I lived in Washington, D.C., I was able to go and attend the March for Life. This is us in front of our banner. This is myself and our seminarians. And it was always a beautiful experience. There would be many, many young people there, families. It was a very prayerful, peaceful experience every year. Not the way the most of the mainstream media would portray it, but it was always a beautiful, prayerful event. And the Marian Fathers, as you know, we spread divine mercy. And one of the things that we would do at the March for Life is hand out divine mercy cards. And so here's Father Gabriel Sillo. At this time, he was still a deacon. This was back in 2018. Father Gabriel is now in the Philippines is serving as a priest there, but you can kind of see in his hands, if you look closely, he's handing out Divine Mercy cards. The Divine Mercy cards that we have look like this. It's the Divine Mercy image on one side and the prayer of the chaplet of Divine Mercy on the other. And we would stand in the street, and as marchers were walking by, we would just hand them to people. And a lot of times, especially teenagers and children would come up, they would love to receive the freebies, right? And so that was a lot of fun, and it was a beautiful witness to God's mercy and an encouragement to people to keep praying, especially the chaplet of Divine Mercy, for life. Well, as I was there one day, many years ago, I was handing out cards, and a very tall young man came by, and I held out a Divine Mercy card. I said, "Would you like a Divine Mercy card?" And he said, "No, I don't think so. I don't believe in Divine Mercy." And I was kind of taken aback by that. I was surprised. I said, "Well, why?" And he said, "It's too easy." And then I was really stunned by that, and he just kept walking, and I didn't know what to say, and so I just sort of turned and continued to hand out Divine Mercy cards. But I thought about it after a time, and I realized, you know, that is possibly an objection that some people might have. Especially if you're an older brother, like me. You know, I was growing up, it was just me and my younger sister. She's 5 years younger than me, and I was the older brother. So what would happen is if we ever got in trouble for something, guess who was to blame? Me. Didn't matter if she was the one to start it, right? I was the one to blame, and my dad would say, "You're the older one, you're the responsible one." Well, sometimes it's like that for us. You know, we see our younger siblings getting away with things that we didn't get away with. Maybe this happens for us now that we're grown-ups too. We look at the world around us and we see people getting away with stuff. And we might think that divine mercy means that people who do sins therefore get away with it. They get off scot-free. And this happens all the time. All we have to do is, look at the news and hear what politicians are saying or hear what's going on in the church or even in our own families. And we can get really frustrated and angry. And we can find ourselves, you know, wanting God to be like in the Old Testament days and the days of Noah and send that flood and, you know, wipe out all those sinners out there. You know, here's the flood scene from Noah that we heard about in the first reading, right? Except that there's something that the Lord is saying to us, something that he's inviting us to do, which is not so much to gaze on those sinners out there, right? But to look instead where? Here, to ourselves, to our own hearts. Mother Teresa was famous for this. One day, somebody asked her, "What's the biggest problem in the church?" And you know what she said? "I am." That's surprising coming from Mother Teresa. We wouldn't expect it. But it's true for all of us, I think we can say it. The biggest problem in the world, the biggest problem in the church, at least the ones that I need to focus on, are right here in me. This is what the Lord invites us to when he's saying, repent. Repent and believe in the gospel. That means I might be distracted by all of the problems in the world, by what people are doing and what they're saying. And that happens too, right? We pick up the newspaper like this and we can be really angry. But instead, if we turn to the Lord instead and focus on him and ourselves, that's not only going to take us away from those distractions that get us all stirred up, but it's going to allow us to focus on the place we need to be focused on, which is our own hearts, which is to be focused on Jesus and to really feel from him that peace and to experience his love and peace in our hearts. That's what the repentance process is, really. It's looking at ourselves, looking at Jesus, and realizing that the God of mercy loves us with his everlasting love and comes to us to take away our sins, to heal us, to make our hearts whole, and to bring us his peace. But in that sense, mercy isn't easy, is it? It's hard. It's hard for me to look at myself. It's hard for me to not be distracted by the people around me and what they're doing. It's hard not to get angry at the conditions in the world and the church and all the problems, right? But turning my gaze and choosing to turn away from those kinds of distractions and looking at the Lord instead, that's hard, but that is the path for us. And so our theme is this Lent is get your soul in shape. And the first step of getting our souls in shape is to remember that it's about our souls, not about the souls of the people around us. So we can recognize, okay, what are the distractions for me? What are the things that get me stirred up? And is there a way that I can maybe turn down the volume on the news, or maybe put aside the newspaper, maybe read it only once or twice a week and not every day? You know, what is the current events going on in the church, and you know, what is this person saying or that person saying? And just say, maybe I don't need to listen to that right now. And instead, we can shift our gaze and focus on the Lord. And one beautiful way that we can do that during Lent is through the Stations of the Cross. The Stations of the Cross are meditations on the passion of Christ, how he suffered for us. And we focus on him and his love for us and what he did for us and how he did all of that to save me, to forgive me, to take away my sins. When we focus on his mercy and my need for mercy, that's how we can really experience his saving peace, his saving love for us, his tender mercy. That's what's going to really transform our hearts. That's what's going to help us to deal with all the distractions in the world. Not merely out of a sense of, well, I don't need to look at that, but even out of a sense of Jesus' love for people, which is to look around at all those quote-unquote sinners around us, and instead of wanting the flood to come back, we can instead say, like Jesus said on the cross, Father, forgive them. They know not what they do. But that kind of response of compassion isn't automatic. It comes from meditating on our Lord. It comes from pondering his love and thinking about how much he's loved us. So then what are we called to do in return? To love the people around us too. It helps also to remember that like ourselves, you know, there are many times in our lives we look back on our past and our sinful times especially, and we can say, wow, Lord, I had no idea. I didn't know. I didn't know my sins were offending you as they are. And so that might also help us to look at people around us and say, Lord, they know not what they do. Have mercy. Instruct them. Teach them. Draw them to yourself. Help them to know what you're doing, what they're doing, Lord, is offensive to you. But then also that might give us a springboard too, to if we have that opportunity, to maybe say something to someone and say, hey, you know, that's not very pleasing to the Lord. Or maybe it's just a simple invitation. Come to church with me, or come to the Alpha program with me. You know, some way to invite people to come and to learn. And the more they learn, then the more they'll understand that certain courses of action or certain activities are just not pleasing to the Lord. This is our invitation. But you see how that kind of invitation to reach out to others with that kind of invitation isn't wanting to thump them, right? It's loving them. It's wanting to bring them to the peace that we've come to know through our Lord Jesus. So this Lent, as the Lord invites us to ever deeper repentance, part of our repentance might be to turn away from the distractions and the sources of anger for us, and instead to focus our own gaze on the Lord and his compassion, so that then we can be that instrument of compassion and mercy for others. And if we can do that, we might have to say, you know, that's not an easy journey. Divine mercy is not easy in that sense. And it doesn't mean that others get off scot-free, just like we didn't get off scot-free. We also need to repent. But that is a beautiful message. And it's a beautiful message for us to really take to heart and for us to bring to our world. So may God bless you in your journey this Lent. And may this time of repentance be not just a time for beating ourselves up or getting frustrated with those around us, but really coming to love others with the heart of Jesus.